Welcome to Kandinsky Station. The hour is 6 a.m. Mercury Standard Time, and the local temperature is a balmy 93 degrees Celsius. We hope you had a pleasant journey to the surface via the Spindle, Mercury's shining tether to space. We also hope that you have acclimated to the local gravity. If you're traveling from a low G point of origin, we recommend you consult the data provided in your virtual pamphlet. If you feel any symptoms of gravity sickness, please seek immediate medical help. Our final destination is Terminator City, where you will be transported in extreme comfort to Mercury's equator and treated to scenic landscape views amid perpetual twilight. Someday, announcements like these could be a real thing, while the thought of living, working, or visiting a planet like Mercury might sound like something out of science fiction or completely insane. The idea is grounded in science fact, and with the right strategies and technologies for living in a hostile environment, humans could make a life for themselves on Mercury. Don't think it's possible? Well, let's find out together.
Stop, take a minute, and enjoy the beauty of science with Mel Science. Want to give your kids a boost in their science classes? Are you a homeschooler who wants to engage kids with chemistry experiments? Choose Mel Science, as they are a leading ED tech company making science accessible and fun. Mel Science offers a range of topics like physics, STEM, coding, med. Each month you'll receive a set with up to 3 awesome experiments. Their subscriptions are for age 5 to 16 plus and include free VR and AR lessons on the Mel Science app. Mel Science is much more than a simple kids experiment box. It's an educational platform. This app allows kids to actively engage in first-hand experience. Mel Science app is designed by experts and approved by professionals and parents regarding safety issues. Mel Science kits are equally loved by teenagers and adults for learning. You can do cool experiments with your kids and create that bond through love and appreciation. Get 60% off the first box of any Mel Science monthly or annual subscription by using the promo code CURIOSITY60, scanning QR code or following the link in the description. Subscribe to our channel and educate your children through fun.
Colonizing other worlds, a dream that has inspired the human imagination for over a century. But until a few years ago, was relegated mostly to science fiction films and novels. However, for some time now, science has begun to deal with this conundrum. And thanks to advances in space technology, long-term missions to other planets in our solar system now seem increasingly within reach. But what are the most likely destinations? If you ask around for an opinion, the most popular answers will talk about the Moon, of course, and then Mars, even Venus, perhaps. No one will think of proposing Mercury, the planet that in the collective imagination is considered the most inhospitable and least attractive of all. Who would ever want to go and live in a place like Mercury? Nobody, of course. If you're thinking of moving somewhere else in the solar system, discard Mercury, they'll tell you. Sure, it's a rocky planet like Earth, and you could walk on it, but its proximity to the Sun makes it decidedly inhospitable. However, you'll be surprised to learn how many good and beautiful qualities this torrid planet can hide, starting with it being officially named the closest planet to Earth. Yes, you heard that right. Despite what common sense suggests, Mercury, not Venus, would be the closest planet to Earth. The relative position of the orbits is always the one taught in school texts, but the distance between the planets changes when measured in respect to time. In practice, the orbits of Venus and Earth are separated from each other by a distance of 0.28 astronomical units, or AU, while that of Mercury is 0.61 AU away from the Earth's orbit. There seems to be no doubt, from a geometric and absolute point of view, Venus is the planet that is closest to Earth. However, if the calculation is made over a fairly long time, we find that Mercury spends more time in the vicinity of Earth than Venus does, so that the average distance between Mercury and Earth, in the long run, is 1.04 AU, while the one between Venus and Earth is 1.14 AU. It's a little bit like what happens to us in everyday life. Between an uncle who comes to visit us once a year and then goes back to his house 100 kilometers away, and the neighbor, who lives for the whole year 100 meters from our house. According to you, who is closer? You have to take this as a curiosity. It is only a different way to consider the measurements, and not a revolutionary discovery, as most of the media reported it. But let's go further. If we want to be able to give a judgment of the habitability of Mercury, it is necessary to accumulate much more data. After Pluto was downgraded to dwarf planet status in 2006, Mercury has once again become the smallest of the planets in our solar system. With a diameter of 4,879 kilometers, less than that of half the Earth, it is even smaller than the moons Ganymede and Titan. Mercury also orbits at an average distance from the Sun at 58 million kilometers, but its orbit is the most eccentric among the planetary orbits, so that at the perihelion, it approaches the Sun up to a distance of 46 million kilometers, while at the aphelion, it can move away up to 70 million kilometers. But the planet's oddities in terms of celestial dynamics don't end here. Do you remember how our moon rotates on itself within the same period with which it rotates around the Earth? This is defined as a one-by-one tidal synchronization. Well, the very slow rotation of Mercury, which lasts 58.65 days, is instead synchronized with a period of revolution around the Sun, which is 88 days, according to the ratio of 2:3. And this too is a way of standing out. In practice, Mercury makes two revolutions for every three rotations, and this means that a possible Mercurian inhabitant would have to wait 176 days before being able to see the Sun return to the sky in the same position. This very special relationship between the period of rotation and the period of revolution, combined with the high eccentricity of the orbit, would produce some strange effects for a possible inhabitant of Mercury placed on the surface of the planet. Within one Mercurian day, it would see the Sun rising in the east and advancing very slowly in the sky, about three times slower than the sidereal motion of the stars. Increasing more and more the apparent diameter near the meridian, the Sun would slow down even more until it would cease completely. Then, the Sun would produce a double reversal of motion to resume its path towards the western horizon, which would reach 88 days later, returning to its original size. Other observers, who were at points at different longitude, would see different but equally bizarre motions. The proximity to the Sun, even in perspective, has always made very difficult the observation and the study of this small planet, which in this way has always remained on the margins of general attention and in part also the scientific one. For example, there are no photos of Mercury taken by the Hubble Space Telescope, which has never pointed its photographic instrumentation in that direction, and not even that of Venus, and only two probes have visited Mercury. It may be the closest of the planets, but it is also terribly difficult to reach. Why may this be? Well, the problem is that to reach Mercury means to jump headlong into the Sun's gravitational well, which would attract the spacecraft until it would reach a speed so high that it would prevent its insertion into Mercury's orbit. The spacecraft would have to find a way to slow down, but this would mean carrying huge amounts of fuel. The only other way is to slow down by making use of one or more gravitational assists with Venus and with the Earth itself, with changes of path that, however, inevitably lead to greatly lengthen the duration of the journey. This explains the lack of attention to the planet shown by various space agencies. The first probe to visit Mercury was the NASA Mariner 10 in the first half of the 70s, which took only 134 days to reach Mercury. The second was the Messenger, with the insertion in the orbit that occurred in 2011 after 7 years of travel. The huge disparity in the flight times of the two missions depends on the fact that the Mariner 10 had only flown over the planet without trying to orbit around it. It was attracted by the gravitational field of the Sun, and without ever slowing down, it had a very fast encounter with Mercury. Messenger's goal was to orbit the planet, which it managed to do only after endless wandering between Venus and Earth in an attempt to dissipate the energy and speed. But now, let's ideally try to descend onto the surface to see what would really wait for us if we really decide to consider Mercury a possible destination. We would find, first of all, that the force of gravity is a little more than a third of Earth's and virtually identical to that of Mars. This means that a person on Earth who weighs 80 kilograms would only weigh 30 on Mercury. According to astronomers, Mercury would be made mostly of iron. almost three-quarters of its diameter would be occupied by a large ferrous core, 3,600 kilometers compared to a total diameter of almost 4,900. This core would occupy 40% of the volume of the planet and would constitute 70% of its mass. In comparison, the Earth's core is only 17% of the volume of our planet. If you're here watching this video, it means you're passionately curious about human spaceflight and the mysteries of the universe. So, subscribe now and be sure to press the bell notification, and you'll never miss out on the updates about the cosmos. One of the hypotheses of scientists to explain a core of these proportions larger than that of any other known celestial body is that the planet was originally larger, and a collision with another large object has torn away its outermost part. Since Mercury has a strong magnetic field, the iron of its core must also be partly in a liquid state. The rest of the planet would be composed of a mantle and a crust made of materials similar to those which is made by the Earth's crust, mainly based on silicon. On Mercury, however, there is no tectonic activity, and the crust does not move. Therefore, seen from the outside, the planet resembles our Moon. It has a grey colour and preserves the craters produced by the impact of meteorites without reshaping its surface. The atmosphere of the planet, composed of hydrogen, helium, sodium, potassium and calcium, is extremely rarefied and therefore does not contain a sufficient amount of gas to reduce the heat and light that it receives from the Sun. Also, its slow rotation exposes for long periods to direct sunlight the different areas of the surface. This results in the highest temperature range of all the planets in our solar system. Without the moderating effects of an atmosphere or oceans like the Earth, the intense solar radiation results in surface temperatures reaching an extreme of 427 degrees Celsius at local noon time. The nights on Mercury are long due to its slow rotation, and since there is no atmosphere to trap heat, it radiates from the surface directly into the cold space at night, and the surface gets very cold, about minus 180 degrees Celsius. Such temperature extremes do not occur on planets with atmospheres due to the insulating effects of the atmosphere that moderate temperature extremes and maintain a warmer temperature at night. Having said that, I think you're beginning to wonder, but then why would we even think of going down to such a planet? To die there soon after? And here's the kicker. Only a few years ago, it was known that on the surface there may also be frozen water. The probe messenger has found it in areas that always remain in the shadows of some craters in the polar regions of the planet. Observations suggest ice deposits at least several meters thick around the planet's poles, and modeling of radar data suggests that these deposits are composed of 90% pure water ice. While some deposits closer to the pole are exposed at the surface, most deposits appear to be covered by a layer of hydrocarbon-like materials up to 30 centimeters thick. In these regions, a human settlement could be constructed using a process called paraterraforming, which can be described as a pressurized enclosure placed within a crater to create a self-contained atmosphere. Over time, the ecology within this dome would be modified to meet human needs. In the case of Mercury, this would include pumping in breathable atmosphere and then melting the ice to create water vapor and natural irrigation. Eventually, the region within the dome would become a livable habitat, complete with a water and carbon cycle. Or one could build a base underground by exploiting some of the many lava tubes, whose existence, a bit like on the Moon, is taken for granted by our geologists. It is hypothesized, in fact, that just below the surface on Mercury, the environmental temperature can even settle on values definitely compatible with human life. Or, and here we come to explain the situation described in the beginning of this video, we could exploit the most prominent feature of the entire planet, the one that made it famous in many science fiction stories, the very slow Terminator line. On Earth, the line that separates day from night moves at a very high speed. At the equator, it reaches as much as 1,670 kilometers per hour, and it is obviously impossible to follow its movement on foot. Only the fastest planes and artificial satellites can keep up with the speed at which the sun rises and sets across seas and continents. But on Mercury, everything is very different. As we have seen, the solar day is very long, 176 Earth days, and the planet has a circumference that is a little more than a third of the Earth's, 15,331 kilometers. As a result, the Terminator moves at a maximum speed of only 3.6 kilometers per hour. Even an elderly person could walk at that speed, thus managing to keep the sun always close to the horizon. From this, to imagine that one day, motorized and self-propelled bases could be built astride the Mercury Terminator, able to keep the temperature on acceptable levels, well, the step is short. Yes, the imagination flies, but obviously, a colony on Mercury would still be a huge challenge, both economically and technologically. Right now, however, humans don't have the faintest idea of how to create a sustainable human colony in space, neither on Mercury or anywhere else. However, it is true that we are in the process of learning how to do this on the Moon and then on Mars, but we still have very fuzzy ideas. Mercury, though, the most consistently close planet to Earth, will have to wait its turn.